Good morning and a happy Sabbath to each one of you. I'm so glad you're here today. And I trust by God's grace you will have God's word for the blessing. Because it's not what I have to say, it's what God has to say in His word that matters the most in that moment. Having grown up in the church, father being a pastor, serving as a pastor myself for about 10 years, I realized a few things. And oftentimes we focus a lot on doctrines and teachings, and we have all of our little discussions and debates within the Christian church. And all of that goes around, comes and goes. And I remember one series of discussions with God around the sun, the moon, and things like that, you know? As time goes by, those things become less relevant, but there are certain things in the Christian life that never lose relevance. And one of those is God's call for us to become a holy vessel, to set our lives aside and allow God to fill us. The problem with that, it seems simple enough, but the problem is we try to fill ourselves with all kinds of things, and it leaves very little room for God to put anything in. So I don't mean this as an indictment on any of us, I think it's our reality. Would you all agree that we tend to sometimes fill our lives up with things that are not the most important things in life? And it leaves little room for God to work. In thinking about this message today, and that text that we just read from Luke chapter 11, Jesus is in the habit of praying. And evidently, the way in which he prayed made an impact on his disciples. So that they listened to his prayer, they were motivated to learn to pray the way he prayed. And it was not singular to Christ, because they also mentioned, can you teach us the way John taught his disciples? I put here on this slide a few of the, what I consider the essentials for a good spiritual life. We need prayer. We need faith. We need to daily study God's word. We need to come together and worship. Fellowship with one another. We need to take time in service to others. And yes, we need the Sabbath rest. Time to just rest and think about all the things that God has done for us during the week. If we do these things, we will find that there's other things, the doctrines and the teachings and all of the things that are going on in the world around us, take their rightful place in perspective. I want to focus today on prayer. My thought was eventually that we might do a series on each one of those, something on faith, something on worship, something on saving, and something on the Sabbath rest. But prayer, I wanted to begin with prayer because I feel prayer is one of the most basic essentials in life. Now, all of you that have been sitting here in the room with me today, every minute you breathe, on the average, between 12 and 20 times a minute. So if it was every 12 times a minute, that'd be about what, 86 seconds? You take a minute in. And if you think about it, if you were to hold your breath, how long would you be able to hold it? I'm not going to try to do that every night. But not very long, right? We need that air. We need that breath. When I was younger and more sick, and I lived in San Diego, California, I had a few buddies, and we got to do a lot of things. And one of the things we enjoyed doing was riding our bicycles. Now, we didn't just go for a bicycle ride. We went for a bicycle ride. We would ride 50 miles a day. And they called this criteria. And sometimes it was races, and sometimes it was just a bunch of people getting together and riding their bike. And I learned very quickly when riding a bike that just like with running or anything else, breathing is essential. Giving you good breath. Because if you're going to ride your bike for 50 miles, it's not going to be on the track. It's going to be off and down the hills and around corners. You have to get plenty of oxygen in if you're going to do that. Now, my friend just found out about something that was brand new, a new thing that they were just doing in San Diego. It was called an Allinder. And so he decided, let's try. Now, I wasn't too excited about the marathon plan. You know, you have to run 26 miles. Okay? Riding the bike was not a big deal. And I loved the sport, so swimming in the ocean was fine with me. But it was that marathon run that I wasn't so sure about. And I remember we practiced and practiced and practiced and practiced. We put in miles on our bikes, we did a lot of running, we did a lot of swimming. And I can't forget that morning, it must have been about 5 o'clock in the morning, people gathering at the start of the night. Most of them, maybe in the main bar, that was just going to go out there and say hi. And that's what they were about, being able to do this. And I made it through. I was nowhere near excited about my way to do that. But one thing I really learned was the principle of breathing. So I put here on the slide, I'm going to be a little hard for some to see, but breathing delivers oxygen to the body, which has been taken by the blood to the cells. And that's what allows the cells to operate, to work, especially the vessel cells. Without oxygen, the muscles cannot convert glycogen and other products into energy, which allows the muscles to contract. So, here's a couple of facts. Number one, the regular air in the room about us, the air in the world around us, has about 20% oxygen in its body. And I don't know how they start figuring this out, but I'm sure they did in the actual assumption. Humans cannot exist on less than 19% oxygen. You need at least 19% oxygen in the air that you're breathing. If you don't have that much, you start to become oxygen deficient. Of course, the closer it is to 19, the longer it takes. So that deficit to build up. But it's interesting that when God created the world, He took 20% oxygen. And He created us as a sort of 19, so there's a little extra. Isn't it nice how God created us anyway? Okay? When you inhale the air that's around us, there's about 400% carbon dioxide. 400%. Now, after our body processes the air, we breathe it into our lungs, and we exhale it out, There's a difference, there's a sense. Other people are out, only have 16% on average, but it has 4% carbon dioxide. So while the oxygen content goes down 4%, the carbon dioxide goes up 100%. Something to think about. Now I'd like to apply that to our spiritual life. In our spiritual breath, the Holy Spirit is the breath that comes in to indwell us, right? The Holy Spirit. And so we take in God's presence just by taking in the oxygen that we breathe. Okay? And this invigorates us, it gives us spiritual life. The ability to save God and to save our fellow man. When we exhale, it's like our soul, our breath. So as we exhale, we're exhaling our doubts and fears, our needs, our weaknesses, our problems, our issues, all those things that make life more difficult, obstacles, hindrances in our way. And as we exhale, we pray, pray those with God. It closes that out, lets it out, and we use those impurities that we have in our life. And that's how prayer works. Prayer is the breath of our soul. So we breathe in God's word of the Holy Spirit. We exhale God's prayer. Now, in the exhalation, there's 16% oxygen, right? So there's also breathing. There's also a return to God in a sense. Things that we are thankful for and grateful for in our life as well. So his disciples here in Luke chapter 11, verse 1, asked Christ, who could have prayer? They could see that prayer was very important to Christ. In fact, we find, I think it's 120-something instances in the Gospels where Jesus would pray. He was praying for someone, praying for his disciples, asking his Father to give him strength to make it through the day. Christ spent a lot of time in prayer. And his disciples wanted to learn how to pray. Now, I find it interesting today that the average Christian seems to focus less on something as simple as prayer and gets caught up in a lot of the other things that we can get involved with. Doctrine, prophecy, arguments within the church. Who has the right to do this? Who has the right to do that? Or why are we doing it this way and not that? So we spend a lot of time and energy focusing on those things, and very little time focusing on those basic essentials, like prayer. In fact, many Christians seem to be left to themselves to try to figure this out. With a couple of teenage kids, I face the same kind of dilemma that many parents face. How do you discuss, for instance, sexuality with your kids? Right? As far as the kind of sticky subject, because sometimes, you know, you think, well, I don't know what it's like to leave it alone. But we all know that if you do that, somebody else, somewhere, is going to give them that information, right? So it's important to have those kind of conversations. You know, in the Christian church, it seems to me like prayer is almost in that same thing. We just kind of assume everybody knows how to do that. And so we don't really talk about it. And so when these Christians come into the church, they're kind of left to their own devices. And it's interesting how to share this. My wife and I attended a church the last time. And it was a small church. And most of the members of the church fell into like three or four family groups. You know, we related to each other, three or four family groups. And this particular church had a tradition of soliciting the prayer before the ministry would speak from the congregation. And also the same thing with the closing prayer, with the solicited closing prayer for someone in the conference, the Orthodox Church. And Mike and I worked there at that church very long before we began to realize that there are certain patterns and trends in the prayer. To the point where if you close your eyes and listen to the prayer, you need to stand the person praying in the step. Because the mode and style of praying was extremely simple. In fact, we visited a church in an adjacent state, many miles away. And while we were in church worshiping, they called for a prayer from the congregation. And the person started praying. And after the prayer was done, I told my wife, I bet they were not family. And when I asked the person, they were shocked that I knew what family they were in. And I said, how did you know that? Because of the way they spoke. So, a lot of times Christians are kind of left to just figure it out. Right? So, they tend to pray like those people that were around us. And we pick up that pattern of prayer. I think it's very important to see how Jesus was willing to teach his disciples how to pray. Do you know what he gave as an example? When they said, teach us to pray words, like John teaches his disciples. Do you know what prayer Christ did? Our Father, which art in heaven. Hallowed be thy name. We know that prayer, right? Let's say it again. Our Father, who art in heaven. Hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. On earth, as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the power and the glory forever. Amen. Beautiful prayer, right? Beautiful prayer. And Christ gave us that prayer as an example. I think it would behoove us to look at that and see what are the elements within that prayer. What is it that makes effective. Because sometimes just watching and mimicking those around us may not necessarily lead us to a most effective prayer life. Just like I had to learn to breathe differently when I was going to run and run the hardest and even take that. So the first thing that comes up is hindrances. I don't want to call them excuses, because they're really not excuses so much as they're just things that get in the way. I think you have your Bible, and I'd like you to turn to James chapter 4, and verse 3. James chapter 4, and verse 3. James, brother of Christ, says, you ask and receive not, because you ask amiss, that you may consume it upon your lust. So the number one hindrance to prayer is mentioned here by James is, we don't ask for the right things. We ask for things that are a little bit selfish, things that we want for ourselves. And when we ask God to give us those kinds of things, it puts God in the closet, right? Because he's trying to help us learn to be unselfish, to learn to be more Christ-like, and be willing to put others first, right? And so it makes it difficult. And so oftentimes when we pray for those kinds of things, we don't get it. I know a lady that every week, she would buy 10 lottery tickets, and then she'd lay them out on the table and ask God for them and throw them away. And to this day, I don't believe she's won more than maybe $20, $30, something like that. Again, it's as an illustration that we ask, we don't get it because we're not asking for the right thing. Paul also talks about it in Romans chapter 8. Romans chapter 8. and sometimes assimilate them. Romans chapter 8, verse 26. Likewise, the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, helps our infirmity, for we know not what we should pray for as we ought. But the Spirit itself makes intercession for us with groanings that cannot be uttered. So this says that oftentimes we can ask for things, or we fail to ask for things because we're not aware of them. We don't understand our true condition. And so we tend to prioritize things based on our perspective rather than prioritize things on God's perspective. And that makes a difference, doesn't it? Okay. Now, the dilemma sometimes that happens is, it is told that during the Civil War, people on both sides were praying for their soldiers. Okay. So which side was God going to talk in a battle, right? Which mother's son was he going to preserve their life? Right. It's kind of a dilemma, because again, we find ourselves in situations where it makes it difficult to help us. A story is also told in the Second World War about two soldiers fighting in war. And they did this boxer and hunted down in it during the night. And the one soldier, every night, would say to himself, "Dear God, keep me and my buddy safe. Don't let any shells fall on us. Don't let any spikes see us. Help us to see the light of day." Every night he would say a similar prayer to him every single night. His buddy, who really wasn't much of a spiritual person at all, listened to this every night, right? They survived. He never was surviving that person. So he would listen, and then he began to sleep. And one night, after his buddy finished his prayer, his buddy was shocked because he spoke up. And he said, "Dear God, just end the darn war." Sometimes we ask for things that are short-term, right? We need something right now. And sometimes we fail to think about the bigger picture. As Christians today, we can pray about changes in the world. We can pray for protection. We can pray for, the storms not to be as devastating in our world. All of these kinds of things, and I'm not saying those are bad things to pray for. And I'm not saying God doesn't answer them. But at some point in time, we're living in a world where there's a war between God and evil. And perhaps our greatest prayer would be like that second prayer of the Bible. Dear God, just end the war. Just come back. Because then we don't have to worry about sickness and sorrow and death and all of those things that we struggle with in our lives today. It's just something to think about. What are you asking for? Because sometimes the things you ask God for make it difficult to see results in your life. And James goes on to say in James chapter 1, if you want to come back to James, he talks about another obstacle that often gets in our way when we want to pray in our prayer. James chapter 1. If any of you lack wisdom, anybody here feel like you lack wisdom? I feel like I lack wisdom. If any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God, that giveth to all men liberally, and upbraideth not, and it shall be given him. But let him ask in faith, nothing wavering, for he that wavereth is like a wave of the sea, driven with the wind and tossed. So let not that man think that he shall receive anything ability. A double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. So if we ask God to clean up the mess in our lives, and yet we keep adding to it, it's a little hard, isn't it? Story told of a woman who, a really sweet lady, came to church for their midweek service every week. And at the end of the midweek service, they have prayer meeting, right? And every week, this good sweet lady, she would say in her prayer, "Dear God, clean the cobwebs from the corners of my head. Clean the cobwebs from the corners of my head." Every week, she said that prayer over and over again. And finally, the deacon in the church, right after she finished praying, he said to her, "Dear Lord, just kill the spider." Sometimes we pray about the problems in our life, but we're not so ready and willing to let God take care of the problems of some of those problems. Okay? We want God to fix stuff, put band-aids on things, but we don't want Him to be the doctor who actually gives us a cure for what it is. And so here again, this is something we have to learn about prayer. What are we asking God to do? Are we asking Him to fix all the messes that we've made all day long? Or do we want Him to reach deeper and pull it out to get rid of it? The problems in our lives. Isaiah speaks to it in this way in Isaiah chapter 1. In the New Testament. Right at the beginning of the book of Isaiah. Let me tell you, there's a lot of things that are said in the book of Isaiah. And in fact, Isaiah has a lot of the prophecies about God. When he would come, how he would come, what he would do with the Savior. And so Isaiah, in chapter 1, verse 15, he says, "And when you spread forth your hands, I will hide my eyes from you. Yes, when you make many prayers, I will not hear, because your hands are full of blood." Well, if God left it there, that would be a kind of depressing message, right? I'm not going to listen to you because you got problems. You got issues. And I'm just not going to listen to you. Your head's not in the right place. And so I'm just not going to listen to you. That would put all of us in a state of despair, wouldn't it? I know it would for me. Well, Lord, I'll never be good enough. I'll never be right enough. My life will never be clean enough. And you're never going to listen to me. Is that what you're saying? And then he goes on to say, "Wash you, make you clean, put away the evil of your doing from in front of my eyes, cease to be evil, learn to do well." So God isn't really here if we look at this in its context, okay? This is the same, "Lord, you're not good enough, I'm not listening." No, he says, "The problem is, I can't listen to you while you're speaking your evil and focused on all of those bad things in your life, okay? And you're not willing to do anything about it. But if you say, "Lord, I don't like how I am. I don't like what I'm doing. I don't like these things in my life," he says, "I'm ready to help you. I'm ready to step in. I'm ready to do everything that's necessary." And so he goes on and says, "Come now, let us reason together," verse 13, says the Lord. "Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wool. If you be willing and obedient, you will eat the good of the Lord." Ah, what a promise, right? He says, "This, let's pray." And that's kind of the next thing that happens with prayer. The key of prayer is a conversation. We breathe in the Word of God. We breathe in His promises. We think about those things, those wonderful things. And it's like getting fresh air into our dark life. And then God says, "Okay, pull it out. Get it out. Get it off your chest. Talk to me about it." So God is somebody you can tell anything. This is how I do for Jesus when he doesn't go put on my Facebook, right? He doesn't put it on my life. God doesn't deal with that, right? When you tell God something, it's for you, right? And that's it. Nobody else needs to be better. Nobody else needs to. We don't need their opinions or their thoughts. We don't need their criticism. You know, the devil's there if he sees that we're praying. He doesn't like that because he knows he's not part of the conversation in a good way. And so he'll do everything he can to keep us from having those kinds of conversations with God. We won't have enough time. We won't be the right place. Or we get kind of caught up in our own routine and we just kind of stay the same little kind of people and everything. I remember when my brother passed away. I was standing in the funeral home, greeting people like they were coming to say greetings. And I cannot tell you how many people said, if you need anything, if you just need anything, here's the call. Right? And I wonder what was the moment when they were expressing something that maybe they thought was the appropriate thing to say. But I can guarantee you that 9 out of 10 of them were nowhere to be found and didn't answer your phone if you were to do this. And so it's very easy sometimes for us to get caught up in gratitude. Somebody had a bad day. So then, good morning, how you doing? What's so good about it, right? So sometimes it's the things we say, and sometimes people don't think they're meaning in it. And to God, that's very important. He wants us to tell him, honestly, transparently, where are we at? What a life of life, what's going on? And we're not willing to be transparent with God. We can even change chemistry. Yeah, really. So you think you're starting, you start to be wise, constant, kind to God, that you have a God that loves us and cares about us, and has told us that, and is listening for us to speak back to him. So how do we do this? Well, there's lots of ways to pray. There's this story written on it. I know there's a boy, there's a minister named Glenn Keenan, who wrote a book, The ABCs of Prayer. And there's many other books I've written on prayer. Taylor Bunchett, one called Today on Prayer. This is lots of books out there about prayer. But you know, it's like a cookbook. You don't have a Betty Crocker cookbook on the counter, but if you don't like baking or cooking, what good is that cookbook, right? If you don't take it down and open it up and pass it, you're never going to be good at cooking food. And it's the same thing with praying our lives. You can read all the books you want, right? Somebody could probably write a book, The Idiot's Guide to Prayer, right? But if you don't pass it with it, what good is the book, right? And so, first of all, I would like to talk about personal prayer. Jesus condemned the Pharisees because he said they go out and they stand out there and they're all sanctimonious and say their prayers for everybody to hear. And Jesus said, "Don't be quiet. There's somewhere over there that you're going to go. Pour your heart out to God. And when you come out of the closet, God's going to reward you openly for your secret prayer." And I would challenge each of us this morning, if you have not experienced that, if you've not tried it, to start. Start today. No time like today to start. Be at home, maybe this evening. Instead of just climbing in the bed and coming up in and say, "God," and then take a mattress or whatever it is, right? And come up and talk to God. Talk to him about today. Talk about what happened. The good things, the bad things. Ask him to give you some insight or some guidance on how you can maybe do better tomorrow or avoid some difficulty in a relationship with him. Try it. You might like it. And first thing in the morning is also a good thing. Before you get a chance to mess up your day, talk to God in prayer, because you might be surprised that they might get better if you talk to him. I listed four or five items here that I think are important and necessary, and I've read these in various books as well. I'm not saying that we must include all five of these in every prayer that we pray to God. God wants an open heart. He wants you to just be frank and open with Him. So it's not about step one, step two, step three, step four. Okay? That's just, no. Step number one, start praying. And that's it. There's no other step beyond that. The things that we should include in our personal prayer, because it will be very strengthened for us, is strength and protection. Acknowledge to God how we kind of mess things up and how sorry we are about that. Repentance and confession are very, very good. In fact, people who don't even believe in God would try to be counselors and you know, helpers to people who have problems in their life. Tell them to be open and honest. Hey, let's, you know, lay on my couch here and tell me all about it. Right? And when you want to talk to God, there's a catharsis, there's a feeling that happens. You can tell God how it really is. And in both countries, God's not going to write you off because you messed up today. But in the act of caring for you, it just takes up to yourself. It's like you serve the Lord, right? And then it takes up to yourself. Ask for forgiveness. You know, when we've offended somebody, we can't forgive ourselves. It's a job that is really empty. True forgiveness has to be given by the victim. Right? But the person who's been offended, who's been wrong. And when we sin, who do we wrong? Who do we offend? We thank God more than anything else. Paul says that we crucify Christ afresh, right? We crucify Him daily, right? When we are insensitive or we commit sin. So if we offended God, ask Him for His forgiveness. And there are thousands of promises in God's Word where He speaks to us in return and says, I forgive you. Right? He says, if we confess our sins, it's not enough. If we confess our sins, He's faithful and just to forgive us our sins. And He doesn't stop there. He says, and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. But God isn't willing to go through whatever you happen to tell Him, whatever the top five on our list, and He stops there. He's willing to change all of us. All we have to do is be in a position where we care about it, where we see ourselves, where we get away. And He takes it from there. I'm so glad God can stop. Right? If I had to fix everything, it would never get fixed. It's kind of like I'm not a handyman. You know? Every time I'm in a seminar about person, unfortunately, I'm not the guy. Right? So, but it's good to know some people that A, are going to come do the job and B, not what you want, right? And that's the thing about God. You can't do it, that's fine. God recognizes that, but He's the best handyman in the world. Right? And He'll fix it. He has all the tools, He has all the experience, He has all the knowledge to make that change in our life. He just needs us to give Him a call. You know that good trouble by your mind isn't going to fix anything for me unless I call you. Say, hey, I got a leaky pipe, can you come help? I don't call Him, He doesn't know I have a need. Okay? Now, God does know our need, but He does want us to call upon Him. And when we do, He's strong enough to help us. He will say, restitution. God, show me how I can fix things that are broken in my life, relationships. And how do I make it right? You know, I've wronged somebody, they don't want to talk to me. They don't want to hear me. They block my heart. So, Lord, what do I do? How do I fix these situations in my life? How do I make it right? Isn't that what Zacchaeus did? Right? When Jesus came to his house and they had a conversation, the first thing Zacchaeus said is, I'm going to make it right. And then whatever I've wronged somebody, I'm going to make it right. So for us to have that position of attitude and experience that says, I want to make it right. God has a way to do that. Because when it comes to relationships, it's not like just money. I mean, if it's not here for this money, right? He's robbing people. So you say, okay, if it's 10 bucks from you, here's 30, right? If it's 20 from you, here's 60, right? But in our relationships, we've been untrustworthy. We've lied. We've cheated. We've done something wrong to somebody. It's hard for that person to be willing to just open up and let us make it right. So we have to ask God to help us because God can soften those things in ways that we can. And there's really experiences over their lives that cause them to think about it. I think about when David, you know, he committed adultery. And Nathan the prophet says that. Can you imagine being Nathan? You got to go to the king, David, of all people. David, who sees the light. David, who, you know, could do all kinds of things with his kids, right? Now, I got to go and tell him what he was wrong. Right? And God's purpose was to restore David. Restore David. To help David see where he was wrong. Because until David saw that, there was no going any further, right? And so Nathan tells a story about a rich man who had lots of sheep and wanted to throw a party for one of his friends. And instead of killing one of the many sheep he had, he went to the poor man down the road and took his sheep. And he only had one, and he took it and killed it and fed it to his friend. How insensitive. And David got up, that's good, right? But through that story, David recognized he had a broken relationship with God and had a need. And so we can find written an example of this personal prayer in Psalms 51. It's David's prayer to God, and I'm so glad it's written down in God's Word so we can see. It's not very long. I'm not going to read the entire psalm. I encourage you to read it on your own as well. Commit it to memory if you can. But it's a good example of a personal prayer and what's involved in what it talks about a personal prayer. He starts off, have mercy on me, O God. What a way to start, right? According to your loving kindness, according to the multitudes of thy tender mercies, blot out my transgression. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity. Cleanse me from my sin. For I acknowledge my transgression, and my sin is ever before thee. Against thee only have I sinned. Now that doesn't really true, but in the long picture, in the big picture, it definitely is true. I have sinned and done this evil in your sight, that you might be justified when you speak and be clear when you judge. Behold, I was taken in iniquity, and sin did my mother conceive me. He points out here, I'm a fallen human being. You know, I mean, from day one, sin is a part of my life. Behold, you desire peace in the inward parts, and in the hidden parts you shall make me your motivation. While you're not interested in what I'm like on the outside, what I've done on the outside, you're more interested in what's going on the inside. That's where you're going to change. It's not about the cobwebs, right? It's about the spider. Purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. It's sin. Creating me a clean heart, O God, renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from thy presence, and take not thy Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation. Uphold me with your true spirit. What a prayer. And that's where we should all sit, right? Some of us could say the same thing. It's so important for us to have this personal time with God. Notice what David does not do. David does not make excuses for what he's doing. David does not say, oh God, I can fix it. I just need a little extra help from you. Right? Sometimes in our prayers, I don't know we don't use it this way, but to say, God, help me this. God, help me that. God, help me this. God, help me that. He's in charge. But I am charged to understand God to give me the ever-ready bunny batteries to keep me going. Or is it, I can't do it, God. You need to do it for me. You need to fight my battle. How many times did God, with the children of Israel, say, stand aside. Let me fight the battle. Let me win the battle. The battle of Jericho. How many choice to go with. Not alone. Not alone. Another time, he said, sit in the mulberry tree. And they knew in the blue sea of mulberry trees, and when they looked outside from the sea, what did they see? They saw the people killing each other. Another time, the city totally surrounded thousands and thousands of soldiers. They prayed to God, and God opened their eyes because they thought they were done for, and they could see souls of God all around their city to get them. But it's amazing to me how God works out our salvation for them. I say the last item I have up on the list here is submission. The matter of us submitting ourselves to God, giving God the control. We can't control what God is. But we don't think we can. We might think we're doing okay. But God can just say, let's go. But I can. He has all the knowledge, all the strength. After all, aren't we fearfully and wonderfully made? God created us in His image. That's personal prayer. A lot more should be said. A second type of prayer is public prayer. Prayer that we share collectively when we worship together in church. Right? And we put every half prayer. How should we have those kinds of prayers? An example of this type of prayer is one that was given by Solomon in 15 chapter 8. And I'm not going to read it, but we see all of these items that I have on my slide are also present in Solomon's prayer to God as he dedicated that wonderful temple. But unfortunately, because of Solomon's later wandering from God, the temple is still to this day remembered as Solomon's temple instead of the God's temple. What a shame that Solomon ended up putting his name on that temple because that took away people from focusing that it was God's temple. But his prayer is fantastic. It's just amazing. We see that chapter, 15 chapter 8, and see how Solomon prays for all the different things. How he asks God to step into their lives. He even mentions the strangers who are not children of Israel, who might come to visit. People like the king of Sheba, who came to visit and was impressed, not only by the grandeur of the temple, but fortunately at that point in Solomon's life, he still gave God the glory. And when she left, she said, this is the most wonderful thing ever. Truly God's temple to see. I wonder if that could be said for the temple that we have. Our church. When people drive by with their money, some godly people at that place. Are they thinking about God when they think of church? Or they think of the people? Oh, they had a good pastor. Oh, they had a good pastor. All the young people's meetings are after. Is that really what makes a church the glory to be? And all of us have probably, wrestle with some of these things because of the COVID experience, right? And we have to come together and fellowship in person like we used to do. But perhaps that's also a kind of little shake-up for us to think about. What is the church for? Who are we? Why are we here? And when we pray for the church, we pray for one another. And part of a public prayer that is most important is thanksgiving. Thanking God for what He's doing for us collectively as a church. Sometimes in our public prayers, there's a tendency for us to tell God what He already knows. Well, Lord, we know that there's problems in the world around us. Oh, Lord, we know this and we know that. God only knows what we know. In fact, if we have any wisdom, He gave it to us. So instead, we should be thanking Him for all the things that He's doing for us and in us and through us. And ask Him to do even more for the world around us, for those who maybe do not recognize or value that it's today we do. Just some thoughts on that is true. One other type of prayer I'd like us to take a quick look at is intercessory prayer. An intercessory prayer is when you're praying on the behalf of someone else. So we're not praying for ourselves, we're not praying for a congregation, our family, but we're praying for someone who has a need. Perhaps they're ill. actually lost their way sometimes. And we're going to see them today. The best example of an intercessory prayer, sort of Christ's prayer in the garden, is found in Exodus, chapter 32. Here's the picture. Moses went up the mountain to God, and he was up there for a long time. And while he was up there, there was thundering and lightning and a big storm at the top of the mountain, constantly, round the clock. And God's presence was there at the top of that mountain. And pretty soon the people got a little bit, at first they were nervous, and then they got worried, and then they said, you know what? God is so terrible, he probably killed Moses. Moses probably isn't even going to come back. He's probably up there dead somewhere. I'm not going up that mountain. Really? And so they sat there and after a while they said, you know what? We are here in the desert. God's up at the top of the mountain. Moses hasn't come back. You know what? We kind of like how it was in Egypt. Let's build ourselves this golden set. And so they did. So back then, God told Moses, don't get back down the hill here. I've enjoyed our talk and all the things we're doing up here, but it's best to go down the mountain and see the effects down there because they're getting a little weighted. And as Moses came down the mountain, the Bible tells us that he was so upset that he took those tables of stone, the same dimensions, and he threw it on the ground. But, and of course, you know, there's the whole thing at the bottom of the mountain. And then Moses, God told him back up because Moses had broken the two tables of stone, right? So God said, come on back up here, I'll write it again for you. And so up the mountain, Moses says, when Moses gets there, God says, you know, I've been thinking about it, and this is terrible people, you know, I can't do it. They're constantly complaining, they're constantly grumbling, they're constantly doing the wrong thing. They don't seem to be responding at all to my love and my care. And then when the season went, remember the season went out? Because I would feed them every day out in the middle of the desert, and they complained about the enemy. Right? God says, okay, you know what? I'm just I'm done with them. I'll tell you what, Moses. I'll start with you. Now, Moses, you know, he's probably 80 years old, and he's all like Abraham, and Moses is right? So God, I'll start again with you. And we'll see if we can get this right. And then Moses prayed, and then it's like this prayer. The Lord, you are everything, God. I know these people are not necessarily what you would want them to be, the right thing to be responding, but don't give up on them. If you give up on them, what is that going to say about you and your character? You know, and Moses just let it all out. And he stood for the people. Now, of course, I think God kind of wanted to go and say that. He wanted Moses to have that experience. And he also, it's written down, and you have to look on the mountain, so Moses had to kill somebody, and he wrote it out in the book, right? So he wanted us to know what that experience was like. And if he stepped in and asked God, you know, please don't give up. And that should be our attitude, too. When we see those around us, and we're in our family, or friends, or social sphere, and they just arrive to be one big mess. And they're not interested, really, in looking to God. God looks to us to step in and say, please, Lord, don't give up on him. Help him out. Fix it. And then volunteer. Because Moses volunteered to go back down the mountain. He took the next tables of stone and he talked to the people again and shared with them all the things that God had said. And I think we should do the same. Can we turn around and those days that maybe have done more? There's a lot more that could be said about prayer, but I want to leave you with this inspiration to say. There are a lot of personal blessings that will come to you and make around you as you experience a better prayer. As you pray, you're going to find an inner peace, right? Remember I started out by saying, if we're a vessel, we fill our vessel with so many things, but there's no room for God to put things in. But by prayer, that's giving up something else. Making room so that God can do something. He can put things in us, and the first thing God offers us is peace. Even before, his love, think of his disciples in that boat on that lake, and the water is about to flood the boat, and Jesus is sleeping. He's sleeping. And he's calling up. And what would the words actually say that would be a great faith? Hey, the next thing he said, peace be still in the water of God. When we ask God, when we have a conversation with God, you know, when we wake up God in our life, right? I mean, he's asleep because we put it asleep, but when we wake God up in our life, the first thing he's going to do is tell us to God. He also strengthens us as steadfast faith. Things may not be so good today, but God has promised a better tomorrow. God says, I am in control, and I will make all things new and true. I think that's a wonderful promise and gift of something that we have hope in. That God's in it for the long haul, and he's going to take it in the end. And then that brings to us a confidence, a faith. Right? As we've given things to God, and we feel that peace that comes, and we feel a hope for the Lord, it can give us some confidence. And people will see that in us as Christians. They'll see our confidence and say, God, how can you be so sure? And that's what we can say with them, have God as love in our life, and in our heart, and give us that hope, and make fear for the Lord. That's what we're saying to us, for the Sabbath lesson earlier today. We're looking to fear for tomorrow, unless we forget how God led us in the past, right? So it's the same thing here as we pray. It gives us that confident faith that God has a lot of faith that he's not going to let us go. And that allows us to have a compassionate love for other people, right? Because in the way that God has given us this experience, we should be willing to share that with others. But I tell you, if you find a good deal, and the little water at the grocery store, you're probably going to tell a few friends, right? You're going to share that with them, the blessing that you've got. And so I think it's the same thing. You should share that love that God gives to us. Now that you have His love, you can share it. If you don't have, if you don't experience that, if you don't make room for it, you have nothing to share with someone else. And then it also gives us a pleasure. And when we stop and talk about things and try to think about it, doesn't it make no sense? We're going to make a purchase or something. We're going to talk to sit down and kind of think it through, put it all on paper, talk about it, mull it over in your mind. And then you kind of get a clear picture of what do I do? Should I do it or not do it, right? And so it's the same thing. So it helps us to clear our vision so that we can see who outside of the eye, but also see us outside of the eye. And then again, exhaling, giving to God everything that's within us that needs to give us. He is to fill us with the Holy Spirit. What a wonderful thing that God is. I would like us just to a brief moment to bring to a field to buy a question. If you haven't talked to God recently, just be so. We'll take just a few minutes and then we'll pray for you. How well are you going to talk about this time? We thank you so much that you've given us such a beautiful experience of faith and the opportunity to share our most inmost concerns and thoughts with you, and that we're always there ready to listen. But not only to listen, but to ask. And you say, if we ask anything in your name, we will receive it. We will do it for you. If you're not willing to withhold from us any good thing, it's in that way. And so, Lord, this morning we ask that we might learn to have that spiritual breath to pray, and that we might make it often for you in our lives. That we might not just try to get you life holding our breath, but that we might learn to get you life by having that relationship with you that comes through prayer. Sometimes, Lord, we learn not what to ask and how to ask it. that we may offer them from the Holy Spirit to assist us and guide us and teach us how to pray. And Lord, we look forward to that day when we will no longer have to speak with you from a distance and pray, but that we can see you face to face, and that we can have these critical conversations with you through our eternity. We look forward to that day. And if there comes to us, help us to not only declare our faith, but those about us, to have an experience with you through prayer.